so that I can do that and honor that commitment that I have. So let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll begin our time. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to be here this evening, and we thank you for the church that calls us together. God, we love this church, and so we pray that your grace would be with us and would be upon us. So Lord, bless this time. Allow it to be fruitful, and somehow, God, use it for the furthering of your kingdom. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. What I want to do is try to explain to you what's been happening in the United Methodist Church basically this year. Now, some of it predates this year, but this year there's been a lot of things that happened that I personally believe that individual congregations and lay people need to know is going on. Now, that I'm going to let you know that I come at this from a couple of different perspectives. Number one, I am a local church pastor. I am an ordained elder in the Methodist Church. I am a local church pastor. And so I come at it from the perspective of a local church pastor. Number two, I am one of the leaders in the Rio, Texas Annual Conference. I chair the Board of Ordained Ministry. And so I handle all matters of clergy relationship to the conference, whether they are active, whether we ordain them, whether we don't ordain them, what status they might be in, things of that nature. So you think of it like this, in the separation of powers that you would have in any sort of democratic government, I reside on the side with, pardon the term, with labor, as it were, with the pastors, with the clergy. And so the board that I chair is about 40 of us, and I lead that group. We handle matters of clergy status. Then you have the bishop and the cabinet. They handle matters of deployment, of where clergy go, and what they're doing out in ministry. Now, when everything is working as it should be, there's a firewall there, is what they call it, what we call it sometimes, where they're not supposed to interfere in what we're doing. The bishop cannot put any undue pressure on us to ordain somebody, to not ordain somebody, to put a status or things like that. And so that's a part of that separation of powers. At the same time, we don't get involved in the deployment part of it. When we are interviewing somebody and deciding whether or not to ordain them, we don't say, well, this person would be a great associate pastor of a large church, but there's no way they could go out into Alice and pastor FUMC Alice down the valley. That's not our purview. When we ordain someone, we ordain them to the entire church. That's the way that works. So I also come at all of these things as a leader in the annual conference. This was one of my roles that I do. So I see it from a higher level also, as opposed to just the local church. So I have these two perspectives, and they're both always present in my mind. The last thing, let me tell you about what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to try to present to you the facts, okay? At least as best as I understand it. You remember Dragnet, just the facts, ma'am, you know? I'm going to try as hard as I can to present to you just the facts without any of my opinion or my interpretation of those things. Now then, I make a promise to every church I ever served. If you ask me a question, I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you the truth at least as far as I understand. And so if you do have some sort of clarifying question or anything, I have very little in my life to ever hide from anybody. So you can ask me whatever you want. I will usually tell you what is going on in my head, my heart, my mind, my life, or whatever. So that being said, I'm going to try to run through this stuff. If you have a question of clarification as I'm going through it, please don't hesitate to raise your hand, let me know. If it's just a question, a matter of opinion or something of that, then let's wait for that to the end so that we can at least get all that information out there. We got it? Last thing. The stuff that's going on in the church is also going on in the nation. It is not reserved for just the church. And there are lots of different opinions on these things. These opinions run deep in us, and they create emotion, they create passion on both sides, and things like that. I am personally of the opinion that the Church of Jesus Christ is a place where we can A, disagree, and B, be in fellowship with one another. And if at any point during the meeting it sounds as though someone is breaking fellowship by going after an idea or opinion that perhaps they do not hold, I end the meeting and we all go home. Understood? The Church of Jesus Christ is a family. We are that family. And so we're going to live in that way together, whether we all land on the same side or not. So, here we go. Current events in Methodism. Most of this, let me ask this. How many of you have ever been a delegate to annual conference, jurisdictional conference, general conference, things like that? Okay, so there's lots of you. And you're still here. God bless you. God bless you. That's great. Well, wonderful. Okay, so you understand this. You know how these things work. They are, though, at those conference levels, they are highly politicized type events. And there's voting, and there's filibustering, and there's deals being cut, and all kinds of stuff that's going on at that level. So most of the issues that are the presenting issues that are causing some of the tension within the church right now have to do with human sexuality, and not only the cultural understanding of human sexuality, but the church's understanding of human sexuality, and then how we live that out as we go forward. This has been going on for about 40 years in the United Methodist Church. The United Methodist Church was formed in 1968. Only shortly thereafter did we start arguing over all of these things. The current wording in the United Methodist Church Book of Discipline, I'm not going to get it exactly right, but it says that all people are of sacred worth and are worthy and welcome in the ministry of the church. However, the church does not understand, or the church believes the practice of homosexuality to be incompatible with Christian teaching. Okay? And so, the exact wording is this: anyone that is a self-avowed or practicing homosexual is not to be licensed as a candidate or a clergy person. Why am I forgetting the word? I do this every single day on the Board of Ordained Ministry. They're a candidate, not to be certified as a candidate, licensed in ministry or ordained in ministry. Okay, so that's the prohibition that's in there. There is no prohibition as to being in the life of the church. Okay, at the General Conference this year, which happens every 4 years, we run on quadriennes. Every 4 years, we have a General Conference. At the General Conference this year, everybody was gearing up for yet another battle royale over this issue. When it kind of got sidetracked, it got derailed along the way, and somebody asked the bishops to come up with a new plan, come up with some new way of dealing with this, because we were basically ripping ourselves apart in the way that we were currently doing it. And so the bishops went away, and they came back with a plan. And they said, well, we want to put together a study commission, basically a task force of sorts. We have no idea how big it's going to be. We have no idea how they will choose the representation. We have no idea about any of these things, except that the bishops are going to put together a task force to deal with every paragraph in our Book of Discipline that has to do with human sexuality. Not just the prohibition on ordination, not just the incompatible with Christian teaching part, but every single paragraph that has to do with human sexuality. And let me just say that this is a far larger issue than just matters of homosexuality. There was an article that came out from a group called MFSA, Methodist Federation for Social Action. Came out just before General Conference, and it was written by a young lady who wrote it anonymously, and she was a candidate for ministry in some annual conference. The reason that she wrote it anonymously was because she was praising our health insurance plan in the United Methodist Church because it provided her with birth control. And though she was a single lady, she was sexually active, and she was extremely happy to have that birth control through the insurance plan. Now, she wrote it anonymously because as a candidate, all clergy members vow to maintain a certain level, a certain standard of sexuality in their life, celibacy and singleness, and fidelity in marriage. So she had to write that article anonymously because she was saying that she's sexually active as a single person. And therefore, she could not go before her Board of Ordained Ministry if they knew who she was and answer that question. So this way, by doing it anonymously, she could still say yes to that question, even though she was not. So don't think that this is just a matter of homosexuality. This is a matter of human sexuality and how we understand how Christians are supposed to live in this way. Okay? So this all came up at General Conference. The bishop said, we're going to form this commission. We're going to look at every paragraph that has to do with human sexuality. It went to the floor for a vote. It was first time, actually, it was turned down. Bill, were you a General Conference delegate? No, not this time. Was anybody here a General Conference delegate? Okay, so you can't clarify for me. All right. So it was turned down the first time. And everybody thought, well, then why in the world would we ask the bishops to do this if we were just going to vote it down? Adam Hamilton from the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection got back up on the floor, said, this is what we asked them to do, and basically remade the motion. Now, according to Robert's rules, you can't re-vote on a motion once it's been defeated, so there must have been some, and I only followed General Conference on Twitter, and everybody said, well, how is this happening? And they said, well, there was a minor change to the motion. The second time around, it passed. And so the bishops were going to put together the special commission to study all of the paragraphs on human sexuality in our book of discipline, and then they were going to come back to the General Conference with a recommendation on how we move forward. Now, they said that they might come back before the next General Conference, which would be in 4 years, in 2020. They said that it is very likely that there would be a called special General Conference in 2018. And so it would be the same delegations. They would come back and they would do this work and vote on just those things. So that's where we left. Well, I'm sorry, Brandon, you can go to the first slide. It's all, I should have said that. That's where we left with General Conference, this study commission. And at the same time, there was a lot of ambiguity as to how that was going to be lived out in the interim time. There were some that said the church should not enforce the current paragraphs on human sexuality while we're studying all this. There were others who said, no, this is our duly elected standard and discipline. We should enforce these in this meantime. So there, and nobody clarified how that was going to actually be worked out. So it was very ambiguous when everyone left Portland, Oregon, and came home. We then all went off into annual conferences for which usually the year after a general conference are very dull because you don't actually vote anything that comes out of general conference until the following year because you have to have time to process it and things like this. Annual conferences this year were anything but dull, I will say that. There were several annual conferences following the general conference that voted on resolutions of non-conformity with the Book of Discipline. You can go to the next slide here, Brandon. These resolutions of non-conformity vary based on place to place, but basically what they did was they put forward resolutions that said, we will not abide by the United Methodist Book of Discipline as it pertains to these matters. Now, there's some conflict as to whether or not that was even legal. A bishop, when they are consecrated as a bishop, take a vow, again, that says they will not allow anything that is in direct defiance of the United Methodist Book of Discipline or the United Methodist Doctrine of Polity to come to the floor for a vote. These things are by definition in defiance. That's the point of having them. So there is a lot of conflict as to whether or not the bishops should have even allowed them to be voted on. They should have called them out of order and moved on. What this began to do, and we had begun to see this even back before General Conference, there is a lot of division within the Council of Bishops. I'm not sure, it never occurred to me that there would be as much division in the Council of Bishops as there would have been in the church. I don't know why it never occurred to me. All these bishops came out of the church. I mean, that's where they come from. And so what ended up happening is that when we're now seeing just how much division there is among our own Council of Bishops and what that's kind of doing. So there were several annual conferences. I stopped counting. I know at least three or four of them did this. I believe, though, that there might have been as many as six or seven annual conferences went ahead and voted these resolutions of nonconformity. They're not going to adhere to the current rules regarding matters of human sexuality. In addition to that, there are several boards of ordained ministry from different annual conferences that voted similar actions within their own board, that they would no longer consider the prohibitions on human sexuality when considering a candidate, that they were taking sexual behavior out of the interview process for a candidate for ministry. I will tell you, 2 weeks prior to General Conference, I received a letter as the chair of the Board of Ordained Ministry for the Rio, Texas Conference from a colleague chairperson up in the Baltimore, Washington Annual Conference, I believe, inviting me to disobey my ordination vows and to follow their lead in ignoring these other paragraphs and this certain standard. I don't get to make that decision for the entire Board of Ordained Ministry. And so that never came before our board. But nevertheless, it was a strange and wondrous event. I've never received a letter like that in my life. And so it was a strange and wondrous event. So you have boards of ordained ministry that are no longer considering the human sexuality restrictions when considering candidates for ordination, along with the other annual conferences who are voting these resolutions of nonconformity that they're just going to ignore those parts of the Book of Discipline. Brandon can go on. At the jurisdictional conferences then, the jurisdictional conferences also happen only every 4 years. Their primary role is to elect bishops. That is the primary function. There are a few other things they do. For instance, SMU is still owned by the South Central jurisdiction of which we are a part. And so several years ago, when the George Bush people wanted to put the library at SMU, that had to be approved by the jurisdictional conference in order for that to happen. I was actually there at that jurisdiction. Were you there at that one? Yeah, you were there too. The debate was just raging and went forever, and then the vote was nearly unanimous. I thought, I just wasted 2 hours of my life listening to this debate, and then you all voted for this. It was just the strangest thing. So the jurisdictional conferences, mainly what they do is they elect bishops. And it depends on how many are retiring to figure out how many that you're going to be electing. This year, the Western jurisdiction, which is the entire western part of the United States for the most part, Colorado West, okay? The Western jurisdiction, at their jurisdictional conference, elected an openly homosexual woman, Karen Oliveto, I believe is her name, as a bishop in the church. Now, this is an important distinction here, because I have a buddy who is the pastor at the United Methodist Church in Childress, Texas, and he had a man come to church shortly after this, just all up in arms, because CNN had on their scroll down on the bottom, United Methodist Church elects first openly gay bishop. It's important to understand that the United Methodist Church did not elect the first openly gay bishop. The Western jurisdiction within the United Methodist Church did so, and they did so in defiance of the stated rules listed in the Book of Discipline. Okay? So that's a very important clarification to be made that the news stations are not going to be making for you, all right? That's an important thing to see. This action now has been challenged. It was specifically challenged by the South Central jurisdiction, of which we are a part, to the Judicial Council. The Judicial Council in the Methodist Church is basically our Supreme Court. They interpret the Book of Discipline and decide if an action that has been taken by a bishop, by a church, by a conference, by a board, whatever, if it is constitutional with the United Methodist Church, with our discipline. Their next meeting is not until October. They will be taking this up at their October meeting and deciding whether or not the action that was taken by the Western jurisdiction is constitutional. There's two schools of thought on this. The first school says that they are going to rule it void because you can't do that. Because the Book of Discipline says that no self-avowed practicing homosexual can be ordained, appointed, licensed, or certified as a candidate. Therefore, Reverend Oliveto was not only not eligible to be elected a bishop, but now actually that she is how we define self-avowed and practicing, that she actually could lose her credentials. That's one way that people think that could go. The other way that people think that could go is that the Book of Discipline gives the power to elect bishops entirely to the jurisdictional conference. And that if the jurisdictional conference chooses to ignore the other parts of the discipline, that they have the right to do so. That nobody else gets to come in and tell them this is what you have to do. So, I have no idea which way that one's going to go. The Judicial Council will consider that in October, and we'll get an answer on how that goes at that time. But it's important to remember, the way that Methodism works is different from other groups. So it's not that the Methodist Church has made some sort of blanket decision. It's that this jurisdiction has made this decision. A couple other things about this. The Western jurisdiction, the way that the church has sort of shaken out over the last several years is that the concentration of United Methodists tends to be more in the South and in the Southeast. The fastest and growing part of the Methodist Church is in Africa. So we are a truly global church. Okay? What that means is when we have our general conference, the entire world delegation gets together and votes on things. As you might imagine, people in Africa have a very different view on this than people in the United States do. Well, 40% of the General Conference delegation comes from Africa. And so every year that the African church grows and that the American church shrinks, their representation for global United Methodism gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So a lot of the acts of defiance and whatnot that are happening are because the group and the church that is trying to change the way the church views all of this is just flat out frustrated. I don't blame them. I mean, if I were trying to change something and it looked like there was no way it was going to happen, I would get frustrated as well. And so the next logical step for them to try to accomplish what they believe to be faithful is to begin to do this. Now, the term that is being used by this end of the church so often is civil disobedience. That's a misnomer. It's not civil disobedience. That's when you peacefully disobey a civil government or something where you really have no choice of being under the laws that you're under. This is ecclesial disobedience, which makes not a lot of sense because you can go somewhere else or do something. You have freely chosen to be a part of this ecclesiastical body. You don't have to be a part of it. And so the disobedience there, philosophically and logically, begins to... there's some really interesting debates going on out there about that. That's all I'll say about this. To put into perspective how the church is shaping out across the country, there are two annual conferences in the state of Georgia. There's the North Georgia Annual Conference, and there's the South Georgia Annual Conference. There are more United Methodists in the North Georgia Annual Conference than there are in the Western jurisdiction. Colorado and West entirely, okay? So that tells you how things are shaping out nationally as far as United Methodism in our church. And why those that are trying to change our polity and our doctrine are so frustrated. And again, I don't blame them for being frustrated. It is a frustrating thing. So... that's what happened at jurisdictional conferences. This is one of the last things that I'll mention as far as things that have happened, and then I'll answer some of your questions. You can go on to the national brand. There's a group within the church that is, however you want to call them, traditionalist, evangelical, orthodox, they have lots of different names, that is forming an organization called the Wesleyan Covenant Association. Okay? The Wesleyan Covenant Association is a group of like-minded United Methodists who are disappointed in the church's lack of accountability in upholding our discipline. And so they're having an organizing meeting in Chicago in October. Now, there's a lot of confusion as to what kind of organization this actually is or is going to be or what the implications of all of this are. And so, from their website, if you go to their website, you can find on their FAQ page, this is kind of how they describe themselves. We are a coalition of congregations, clergy, and laity from all jurisdictions that are committed to promoting ministry that combines a high view of Scripture, Wesleyan vitality, Orthodox theology, and Holy Spirit empowerment. So you hear a lot of Wesleyan language here. The Wesleyan Covenant Association seems to be very big, from what I can tell, on kind of recapturing one of the original Methodist Wesleyan spirit that was a part of the church back when it was a movement prior to it becoming institutionalized and things of that nature. There were articles that were published where some source was saying that this group was going to be create the framework for a new denomination. That when the United Methodist Church split, the Wesleyan Covenant Association would be where all the evangelical Orthodox people go. Again, from their website, this is how they respond to that statement that they are setting up a new denomination. That is not the association's intent. The WCA hopes the UN Church can remain united. We pray we can all find ways to live as Jesus' joyful and obedient disciples in covenant with one another. We long for a church that leads with grace and is committed to the truth of God's will revealed through Scripture and embodied in Jesus Christ. We plan to work for a vibrant expression of Wesleyan Christianity within the United Methodist Church. There are lots of groups like this already in the Methodist Church, okay? You've probably heard of some of them. There's Good News, and there's the Confessing Movement, there's the Reconciling Ministries Network, there's Love Prevails. I mean, all of these different groups have their own agendas that they're working toward and trying to see accomplished within the church. So Wesleyan Covenant Association, a lot of people are saying, one more group, really? Do we need one more group? Others are saying, no, this is going to be completely different. I got no idea. And so that sort of remains to be seen. However, it is a significant development that's happened in the last few months. These things literally happened in the way that I've kind of unpacked them here. You had General Conference, then you had the annual conferences doing their nonconformity, then you had the Jurisdictional Conference, and then you had the Wesleyan Covenant Association announce that it was organizing in Chicago in October. So that's just sort of how things have unfolded. There's been so much rhetoric around all of this stuff for so many years, and then in the span of like 6 months, everything just broke out all of a sudden. I've never seen anything quite like this. It's a fascinating development. And I don't know where it goes. If I had to wrap up this portion of it before I get to kind of what's next specifically for us, I have a lot of questions as to what's going to be happening in the future of United Methodism. I don't know what that's going to be. If I were a gambling man, if I had to put money on today, I would probably bet that I don't retire a United Methodist minister. Not for any other reason than I doubt that the United Methodist Church as it exists now will exist then. Now bear in mind, I'm 38 years old. My mandatory retirement is 72. I got a while. So if I had to put money on it, that's kind of where I feel like this is headed. And let me just say this personally here. I've mentioned this before in some circles. I was not raised United Methodist. I joined the church in college. What I found in seminary was that I was far more passionate about being United Methodist than a lot of my friends who were raised in the church, that just sort of took it for granted that this was their church. This is my church because I chose to be here. It's not some place that I was just shepherded into by my folks. I had a crisis of faith, and I sought, and what I found were answers in John Wesley and the Methodist movement that so inspired me and set my heart on fire that I said, I have to be a part of those people. And so the prospect of this church perhaps breaking up is devastating to me. I have not come to grips with that yet, or how I would handle that at this moment. I still pray every day that it won't actually come to that. But at least as I stand here today, it doesn't look great, but God has done more miraculous things than save this church. So you never know. You never know, I suppose. So that brings us then to the logical next question. What's next for us here at Coker United Methodist Church? Number one, we focus on the mission field that God has given us. God has placed us right here for 100 and some odd years. Do you think that God wants us to reach the people of San Antonio in this part of the town? Absolutely. How many churches that have existed this long are still in their original location? I'm sure there's a lot, but I would bet the majority have moved at some point out where people are going or this or that or whatever. This church has been right here. And God has us here for a reason, to reach the people around here. And we will do that. We will mobilize our church with the good news of Jesus Christ, and we will go and reach the people around here. That's number one. Number two, we're going to welcome everyone into our church. I have never met a single person that was not in need of the grace of God. Have y'all? I've never met a single person that was not in need of the transforming power of the Holy Spirit that God has given to us. And if the church is going to get involved in saying these folks can come and these folks can't come, then that's not a church I want to be a part of. Okay? We're going to welcome anyone and everyone that is seeking to know Jesus Christ deeper and better. And we're going to minister to them. Because God meets us where we are. God is never content to leave us where we are. But God will always meet us where we are. And then let the Holy Spirit do what only the Holy Spirit can do. And then three, we're going to pray for the United Methodist Church. We are a United Methodist Church. I am a United Methodist elder. And I have submitted to the authority of the Book of Discipline in the United Methodist Church, to the authority of my bishop and my district superintendent. I intend to uphold those vows, and I intend to pray daily for my church. And I hope you will join me. I hope you will join me in praying for the United Methodist Church. Because our witness is so much more than what the world hears through the news. I don't know of another global denomination like we are. The Anglicans are different. The Baptists are different. Everyone else is different. The Presbyterians are different. No, there is no other worldwide denomination like the United Methodist Church. And our witness is just, it's not getting out there. That they're only covering the parts of the church that are fracturing. We need to tell the good stories. So we need to pray for opportunities to tell the good stories to the world so that they can hear what our church is doing. Nobody understands that any time, anywhere in the world, a natural disaster strikes, UMCOR is there before anybody else. Anybody else. The Red Cross gets the pub and the Salvation Army. Those are great organizations, but UMCOR is always on the ground almost before anyone else. And that's us. That's us doing that. And so we need to pray for the church, and we need to look for opportunities to tell the story of the United Methodist Church. All right, that's what I got, okay? It's 4:35, so I've got 25 minutes. If you have any questions that you would like to ask about anything that I've said here or things like that. Yes, sir?
I'm getting the impression, you brought up the WCA a minute ago. Mm-hmm. I don't get the impression they really have a agenda. It sounds to me like, unlike the other splinter groups that have their own agenda, they're just simply saying, run the church the way our doctrine has it.
So I have a lot of friends who are on the steering committee of this particular organization. I'm not engaged in it right now, but I have a lot of friends that are, it's actually kind of like being an athlete in college. They're like recruiting me. It's kind of fun. So here's what I know about my friends. They desperately want to be United Methodists in the way that the church is currently set up. And their biggest frustration is that they can't seem to do that. That you don't know if you, when you're dealing with somebody, if you're dealing with somebody who's going to, quote, play by the rules or not. So what they tell me is that the organization is meant to be a network of people, associated people, where we can draw fellowship and strength from each other in that sense. That's what I have heard from them. So again, I'm not privy to all those conversations, so I don't know. I just got to take their word for it. So, yeah. Yes, sir?
We're somewhere along the road that other denominations have already traveled. Is there any lessons learned from those denominations that either have split or fractured or whatever, things that might be of any use to us?
Yeah, I think so. And there's a couple of really interesting points about that. The other churches that have gone down this road, primarily the Episcopalian Church in the United States, and the Presbyterian Church in the United States, which is the denomination that I grew up in, by the way. They have both gone down this road. And in both cases, so this is where we don't have something learned, okay, and then I'll get to where we do. In both cases, those churches went more to the cultural left, and it was the more of the conservative side of the church that felt disenfranchised and left and formed new denominations or joined other denominations that were currently existing. What's happening in the United Methodist Church is different. The United Methodist Church has actually moved culturally more conservative. Other decisions that happened at General Conference moved us more in that direction. Where the hang-up comes in the United Methodist Church that makes the conservative side of the church not very happy is that the progressive side of the church just stopped playing by the rules and nobody is calling foul. Nobody's throwing the flag or something like that. The people that have been entrusted to do that aren't doing it. That's the frustration. So it's interesting. If the church had just gone more culturally left, then the conservatives could have just said, well, all right, we're done, like all the others have done. That didn't happen. The church went more conservative. but they're not the whole church isn't living into that, so nobody knows exactly what to do with that. And maybe that's what the WCA is about. I'm not real sure. Now, what we have learned is that in all of those situations, the split in those churches was ugly. It didn't go well. It wasn't a pretty thing. And I think enough people from both sides of this debate in Methodism have learned from that. And one of the things, from my understanding, that they told the bishops when they said we need a way forward is, if it doesn't look like there is a way forward for us, then tell us how to gracefully go our own way. And so there is a desire in the church, I believe, that if it's not going to make it, how can we more gracefully do our own thing? And there's lots of ideas about that, because the church is so big now, with so many institutions and the pension plans and all of these things, that there's a lot of thought of can United Methodism stay together in its worldwide outreach, but then have two branches under the one head? I don't know. You know, there's lots of different plans. Like, so I think there's a desire to make it more graceful than what has happened in our sister denominations. I don't know if it's a reality. So, yeah.
Along that line, I think I read that the African United Methodist Church is more conservative than what exists in the United States.
Far more. Okay. Far more, yes.
That's larger. That may be a driving
factor. Christianity as a whole, take United Methodism out of it. The center of Christianity is no longer in the global West. The center of Christianity is now in the global South. It is in Africa, Central, and South America. That's the center point of Christianity. That's the epicenter where things are beginning to grow and go out of now. So that's turning a lot of things on its head. But yes, that has a lot to do with somebody that I read an article by somebody who was at General Conference, and they I believe were on the conservative side of the fence, and they were walking in with a friend of theirs who was actually on the progressive side of the fence. And as they were walking in, the friend said, we know we don't have the votes to change anything, but we're going to burn the house down while we're still here. And so that then led into a lot of these other events and things that have happened. So that's another thing. If you're interested, United Methodism, of those other denominations, we are a uniquely American denomination. The Presbyterian Church was started over in Scotland. The Episcopalian Church is the American branch of Anglicanism, the Church of England. United Methodism only exists because the American Revolution happened and the Church of England pulled out, and Wesley did not think it was fair for the people in America not to have the sacraments or the witness of the church anymore. So he took it upon himself to ordain his Methodist lay preachers, and thus the Methodist Church was born. We are an American denomination, which means we are inherently democratic. We elect delegates, we send them to conferences, they do politics, they vote, we rule, we use Robert's Rules of Order, all of those things to govern ourselves. So now the question comes, is democracy self-correcting? When a group who have agreed to run themselves by a democratic process decide on something, and then one group decides, we don't like that. Can they just, in fact, act on their own? How much power is there within the rest of the body to change that if those set up in charge of maintaining that order don't maintain that order? So if you're a sociologist or a political scientist, fertile ground for some research right here. I'll tell you that right now. So, yes, sir.
Okay, so basically what you're saying, like the basic United States rights issue here versus the government issue.
That's a very, very good comparison. I think that's a very good comparison. If you didn't hear him, he said it's basically like a state's rights versus a federal government kind of an issue. You have annual conferences that don't agree, and so they're all kind of doing their own thing. And so I think that's a great way to put it, yeah.
Global, how does the African delegation fit in with the democracy of the United States? Number one. Number two, are they more conservative or more liberal?
They are more conservative. They are highly conservative. And fascinating thing about this, the African delegation, when they come over to the U.S., their big complaint is that they're only living the faith the way they were taught by the Methodist missionaries who went and evangelized them originally. They don't understand why the American church has now changed its mind on a lot of the way that the faith is lived out. The biggest, that, like I said, they're 40% of the General Conference delegation now. By the next General Conference in 4 years, they will be over 50% at the rates that they are growing. And so that's what I'm saying. The Methodist Church is ceasing to be an American denomination. It's turned into a truly global denomination. So, yes, ma'am.
What does the Council of Bishops think? Are they unified?
They are not unified at all. The Council of Bishops, so there's a Bishop O, who I believe is in the Ohio Conference. Isn't that ironic? His name is Bishop O, and he's from the Ohio Conference. It's O-U-G-H. He is the current president of the Council of Bishops, and he has issued a few statements. And in an effort not to make anybody too upset, they've made everybody upset. Exactly, it's fair. If you're going to make anyone upset, make them all upset. And he did a good job of that. What you have is you have the Council of Bishops issuing their official statement. But then, I believe it was a week and a half ago, the lead bishop from Africa issued his own statement that said, basically, don't get it. It's not that hard. We elected these, we voted these rules, follow the rules. And the African bishops were willing to offer leadership if it was needed and things of that nature. Then you have other bishops that are issuing kind of unofficial statements as well about they tend to go more with the groups that are trying to make new things happen and make changes, and so they're going to lead their annual conferences in the way that they feel is right to do so. So there is no, I don't believe that there is a lot of uniformity within the Council of Bishops at all. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, is it true that this year they finally voted to remove themselves from this reproductive rights organization?
They did. There was an overwhelming vote to, I won't say overwhelming, there was a majority vote to remove. The United Methodist Church was a charter member of what was called the RCRC, the Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice. Even though our social principles state that we are against that abortion in that sense, it's a nuanced statement, you should go read it if you're interested. But we voted to remove ourselves from the RCRC. Since then, several individual annual conferences have, though, decided to vote to join RCRC on their own. So that, again, goes into that nonconformity issue. That's almost been pushed to the side because of all the other stuff. But yes, that's happened as well. Yeah, Jim?
Is there any precedent in the history of the Methodist Church of a division deciding to be nonconformist and us actually, the rest of the Methodist body acting on that and exercising their authority?
I don't know. There have been lots of splinters within Methodist history. The original Methodist Church in America was the Methodist Episcopal Church. And then you got into real states' rights versus federal government, slavery-type issues, and that splintered the church into Methodist Episcopal Church North and Methodist Episcopal Church South. And then from there, you had further splinters. That's where the AME Church came from, the AME Church Zion, and then what was called the CME, which is now stands for Christian Methodist Episcopal, but at the time stood for Colored Methodist Episcopal Church. So there were lots of splinters that came off of the church at that point. And then what ended up happening, well, and then the Free Methodists came out of there, and then the Wesleyan Church all came out of that as well. What ended up happening then through time is a lot of those groups got back together. And so in 1923, the Methodist Church North and the Methodist Episcopal Church South came back together. And became the Methodist Church. And then in 1968, the Evangelical United Brethren Church merged with the Methodist Church and became the United Methodist Church. But all of those splinters weren't like this one. And so while we do have a history of kind of factioning off, this one's new. And so I don't know how this one works out in the end.
If they were to exercise their authority, what would they be able to do?
Well, what would end up happening, well, what should have happened was that the bishop should have taken any of these resolutions of nonconformity and ruled them out of order. They never should have been voted on in the first place. The judicial council can go back and rule them out of order and say you can't do that. Now, if your resident bishop is unwilling to enforce the discipline, it doesn't really matter what the judicial council says. I mean, it doesn't matter what anybody says. If the speed limit is 35, but the cop that sits there every day just isn't going to get out of his car, it doesn't really matter that it's 35, does it? And so That's where it comes down to. The role of the bishop is to guard the church. And so when you have bishops that disagree as to what you're guarding the church from, because that's what it boils down to, is you have some that are guarding the church from moving more cultural, and then you have some that are guarding the church from being what they believe to be hateful. And so if you have a disagreement as to what you're trying to guard the church from, then you're going to have a disagreement on how that lives out. This is what it all boils down to, okay, is that we in the church are talking past each other, okay? Like I told you, I follow General Conference exclusively on Twitter. I did that for a couple of reasons. Number one, I don't have the time to sit there and watch the live stream all day of what's going on because they take so long in all their debates. Number two, I knew that my stomach couldn't take it. And so I was wrong to think that I could take it on Twitter. I couldn't. I mean, it was awful. Absolutely awful the way people spoke to each other. But it was about a week into it that I was looking and reading through several tweets, and I finally realized that though we're using the same words, we have extremely different definitions for those words. And so someone can talk about grace and biblical fidelity and things like that and mean something entirely different as the person that they are conversing with. And so while the presenting issue, everybody's getting all hot and bothered about, that's not the issue anymore. The presenting issue is no longer about human sexuality. That's just the easy one for us to talk about. It really has to do with which way we want to go as a church. Does the church want to look more like the culture around us? Or does the church want to be different and more like it's always been? And that's where the disagreement is going and how we live that out, how we play that out. So people are just talking right past each other, using the same words with very, very different definitions in them. So, yes, ma'am.
I know these people who have different ideas just form a different denomination.
Well, because they're going to stand up here and say the exact same thing that I did. I love this church, and this is my church. And I want to be a part of my church, even if I don't agree which way it's headed or something like that. And so, I mean, that's the answer that I have heard the most often. And so I think that's probably, but honestly, I mean, I'm not going to presume to speak for anybody. I will simply say that's the answer that I've heard the most. Yes, ma'am.
Who is over the bishop?
So, the General Conference is the only body that can speak for the entirety of the United Methodist Church. And that is a committee of about 1,000 people. And so, 860. Okay. There you go. So, if you want to try to get something done with a committee of 868 people, God bless you. It's very difficult, though. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The book is, he can be removed.
Yes.
Under certain circumstances.
Yeah.
For certain causes. Are there causes for the bishops to be removed?
Yes. So the bishop, this to answer your question in reality, the General Conference is the overarching body. Every jurisdiction has a committee on episcopacy. And the committee on the episcopacy is basically the SBRC for the bishops. The bishops report to that committee, and it's made up of clergy people, lay people, things of that nature, and they determine, and it happened a few years ago in our jurisdiction where the Committee on the Episcopacy decided that the bishop was not doing their job well and tried to remove them. The jurisdictional conference ended up agreeing to do so. The judicial council came back and said they didn't follow proper process and reinstated that bishop. The Committee on Episcopacy for the jurisdiction is ultimately the authority that is over those bishops. Bishops are not a separate order of the church. So every bishop that is elected is still an elder. They are a colleague of mine, an elder. Though I have to submit to their authority, they are consecrated a bishop. But it is not a separate ordination or a separate order. And so we're all accountable in some level or another. And so they are accountable to the Jurisdictional Committee on Episcopacy. And each annual conference has its own committee on episcopacy as well. So there are those levels of accountability. But you can file charges on a bishop for the exact same way you file charges on a clergy person. They are accountable still to all the same ones. No one is willing to do that. I mean, because it costs so much money and it takes so long to litigate these things within the church. And then very rarely does anything happen because we don't have any standards of consequence. There were actually several resolutions that went before General Conference this year that would make uniform punishments for people brought up on charges for certain things like this. Those were never voted on. The way General Conference works is you just go until the time runs out. Whatever resolutions aren't gotten to, just don't get gotten to. And so I think they got through like 15, 16 resolutions out of the 100 and something that they had because of all the debate they had. So I saw this hand, and then I'll work my way around over here. And we've got about 8 minutes left.
I'm Lori, and I'm a member of the church. And when you were talking about this, it reminded me of what happened to me when I was a child. And I was a Girl Scout, and I went to camp. And the girls started to make love to me. And I mean, I was a child. I didn't know. But I had brothers, and I knew for girls to be trying to do things with me, that was terrible. That was terrible. And I told the teacher, and she said, oh, well, sometimes little girls are affectionate. And I thought, no, little girls are not affectionate like this. And it scared me to death, and I have such a prejudice now about that. That, you know, I believe women are women and men are men. And I just, somebody that would do that to a child is crazy.
Terribly sorry. That is a terrible experience. But I think you put your finger on something that is very true in this. As I said earlier, I've never met anybody that's not in need of the grace of God. And what we have is people that have deep-held beliefs on two different sides of an issue, and the fact that we're all sinful people. And so we don't always do a great job of expressing ourselves in a good and holy way. And then that leads to defensiveness, and then that leads to attack, and then all these other things along the way. We are broken people, and I think that should never be overlooked in these debates and about how we handle ourselves in all of these things. Hang on, Bill, I saw some hands over here. Yes, sir.
You mentioned before that the national media, 2 minutes, sound mm-hmm. doesn't get the story right. So where do we go for information to help us better understand the issues and understand the developments that are happening?
You're always welcome to come to any of the clergy here. Most of us keep up with things that are going on in the church. David is the vice chair of the Board of Ordained Ministry. So he and I both have more global views because we're in leadership in the conference. Damon is very up-to-date and educated in all of this stuff. So you can always come to any of us. You can go to your district superintendent, Carl Rolfs, at the United Methodist Center down here on Heatner Road, is always more than willing to talk about these things. He has been a great encouragement to me in my ministry. There are lots of people around, but any of us, you're always welcome to give us a call there. You can go to umc.org. That's the official website of the United Methodist Church, and they have they do a fairly good job of covering the news for the church, and they can speak United Methodist. I've been impressed recently that United Methodist Communications doesn't ever seem to lean one way or the other. They simply report the facts, and they do a pretty good job of doing that. So that's another place you could go. Rick and Charles, and then over here to Bill.
Looking at the umbrella of the General Conference mm-hmm. and the umbrella of the annual conferences, they're going to be able to sort themselves out. Mm-hmm. What do we do here to improve our own local church?
Exactly what I said. We reach the community that God has given us to reach. We welcome anyone that wants to come and be introduced to Jesus Christ at this congregation, and we pray for our denomination. We do those three things. I'm not worried at all. Yeah. Charles, I'm in the building.
It seems our finally having a Spanish language service is one of the things that's been needed to be done for a dozen years to improve our people that come. How does the powers be view us having it in Spanish or other languages?
Oh, gosh. In our annual conference, they wish every church had one. I mean, if you want to reach people in San Antonio, the ability to be bilingual and to do worship in multiple languages is almost pivotal. And so the conference, I promise you, I I told David just today, there was a family in our 11 o'clock worship service today that is monolingual Spanish. The husband, the father speaks a little bit of English, enough to come, and they're Baptist. But when they moved here, the church that helped them out was Copeland, and they came to our worship service, and they were impressed. They were deeply moved by what happened. So they have a meeting with David later this week, and they're extremely excited about Rios de Gracia and about being a part of that congregation. I told David after church, I hope everybody understands how fast that service is going to explode. It's going to be big. And the conference is then going to look at Coker yet again as a leader and see that we're reaching into this community. So it's going to be a big deal. Yes, sir. Bill, and then right back here.
One comment. I don't think the church is going to split. It's going to be very difficult. We don't own the church.
That's right.
For example, if we decide to get up and walk off, we can walk off. But the church owns all that property and all the buildings. That has come up in general conference several times.
Yes.
Trying to change it where a church is splinter off. Well, you splinter off, but you leave everything there and we sell it. And so that is going to, I think, more than anything, that financial lock is going to hold us together. And you're probably going to retire from Methodist preaching.
I would love that. I hope you're right. I really hope you're right, because I would really love that. Yes, ma'am. The United States law let me put it this way. The implications of that are still being figured out. The changes in the law do not impact church law. And the government has done that intentionally. Where matters of church law conflict with civil law, the implications are still being borne out. Now, obviously, if church law causes us to, break the law somehow, there's going to be implication. But they, in the matter of, say, same-sex marriage or something, the government's not going to come in and tell a pastor who is a United Methodist pastor and therefore prohibited by the discipline that they can't be United Methodist, that they have to do something that their church prohibits them to do. There's not going to be anyone to force them doing that. And so there are other matters, like Bill brought up, the trust clause of ownership and things. Those are now being challenged in civil courts. And it all depends on where you are. Some civil courts say, no, this congregation paid for the building, they get their building. Other civil courts go, no, you were part of this denomination, they own it under the trust clause, they get to keep it. And so a lot of churches are using it to rack up a bunch of debt in building buildings and then leave. And because the denomination then says, well, wait a minute, we don't want all this debt, all this now empty building. And the church is like, too bad, you said you owned it, we don't want it anymore. And so that's happening in a few places as well. It's all kinds of bad stuff, though. So the implications are still, I think, being borne out. I'm going to take these last two, and then we'll be done. Yeah. People will say things to get what they want accomplished. And so it means necessarily in debates like this, that means that you end up painting your opponent in a certain light. And what I have found is that people on either side of this are nowhere near what their opponents tend to paint them. Which is what I said from the very beginning, is that it is my expectation that as brothers and sisters in Christ, we live as brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of how we might fall on these things. We love each other in Jesus, and we strive to be more like Jesus each and every day in doing that, to be transformed by the Holy Spirit. So that's why I don't go to the Rio Texas Facebook page anymore. I'm just being honest with you. I got off that group. I couldn't take it anymore. There was one last one. Yes, sir.
Would you schedule another one of these up there?
I'd be happy to. Somebody asked me, is this a one-time thing? when there are things happening in the church, I'm happy to do these and let you know, here's what's going on. I do think it's important for a congregation to know what's going on. So, and again, you're always welcome to come and find me. I'm happy to tell you what I've heard or what's happening, things like that. This isn't the end of it. So please do join me in praying. Remember, we're going to do three things. We're going to reach our community. We're going to make sure that everyone that comes through those doors is greeted warmly and given the opportunity to meet Jesus Christ. And we're going to pray for our denomination. Okay? Those are our three things. Let's bow. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the opportunity to be brothers and sisters. And God, I pray, would you make Coker an example? Make Coker an example to this entire denomination. God, where we can have real, fruitful conversation and discussion. Even if we might disagree somewhere along the way and say, but you know what? You're my brother and you're my sister in Jesus Christ and I love you. So God, make us an example and use us to reach this community. In a country that is becoming more and more polarized, perhaps, Lord God, could we be a place where people come together under the banner of salvation through faith alone in Christ Jesus. So we thank you, and we pray that you send us out into the world to do just that, to reach people with that good news. And we ask it in your holy and powerful name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.